need this. Oh, sorry. My good.
छोड़ दो माइनस कर लेना
स्टार्ट शेयरिंग योर स्क्रीन आई गेस इट्स ऑलरेडी
ऑल राइट सो हेलो एवरीवन वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू थैंक यू फॉर मेकिंग ऑन अ सैटरडे मॉर्निंग माय नेम इज जतिन गोयल Here to stay. So I can't do anything about it. All right, so my name is Jatin Goel. I'm a software engineer with 4+ years of experience ranging from tools and automation, REST APIs, cloud services, and programmatic advertising. So without any further delay, let's get started. Memory management in Python. What is memory management and why do you care? So for most of you must have already tried competitive programming. Has any one of you ever faced memory limit exceeded errors and ever wondered like why it happened? So we'll cover that. So knowing about memory management helps you write efficient code. It helps you get across those kind of errors and makes your code more efficient and more readable. More readable is again it's doubtful, so it depends. Now let's first get started with variables. Let's first cover C style variables, where in C we had a static type of variables. You need to define the data type of that variable and then the value int a5, int a10. What does it the variable look like in memory? So we have the variable. Variable has the location where the data is written in memory. And the data for integers, it's written as a binary over there, binary form. So 0101010. What happens when you actually try to update that variable? So now in the same C code, you just did a equals 15. What does that actually mean? The value is updated. So what it does is like what it means. It just goes to that memory location and then updates the value at that memory location for that variable. How many types of variables are there in Python? Anyone? Types of variables in Python. Variables. How many? So let's say we have integers, strings, and there are booleans over there in C. Let's say, right? You may be surprised. There are none. So actually, Python does not have variables. Python has so let's before actually go there let's just rewind back most of you must have already heard somewhere or read somewhere Python everything is an object so what does that actually mean Python actually has names so names which have references to those objects in memory objects can be of two types basically in Python simple objects and container objects simple objects which are our numbers strings you just assign that there and containers could be dictionaries lists or user defined classes containers basically are like can contain so they contain whether it's it could be like simple objects other container objects as well so let's say you have a dictionary you can have sub dictionaries or like Is it better? Okay. All right. So user defined. So let's say containers, right? Any of dictionaries or lists. You can have strings, integers, numbers, or like booleans or sublists as well, or other dictionaries. How are objects stored in Python? So we have Python uses stacks and heaps for object storage. So stacks are actually used for storing all the variables. So we'll be using variables and names interchangeably as part of this talk. So stack will store all the variables or the names, and then the heap will actually have the data for that name. So let's say when you define your main program, it will have you defined x equals 10. X will go in the stack. The value 10 will go in the heap. So x will have a reference to that memory location in the heap. And then when you define, let's say, a function abc, and then inside that, when you define x, what does it do is like it creates a different memory location in the stack or function abc, a local namespace. And in that, it has the variable x, the name x, which is different from the x defined in the main. References. So we talked about that names have references to objects, but really, what does a reference mean? So it's basically just a name that has the memory location of that object in memory. Now let's talk about reference count. So for any object, we maintain a reference count. This is how it looks like. So when you do in Python terminal, you do x equals 10, it creates an object in the memory with the value 10, and then it object is created in the heap. The variable, the name x is created in the stack, and then stack has a reference to that object. So we right now we set it to 1, the reference count is 1. Now what do you think will happen when you do y equals 10? You may think that it creates another object, but it does not. It just points to the same object and increases the ref count to plus 1 becomes 2. Now similarly, when you do on the next statement, you take a list and then assign the same objects, same values in the list. It will increase the reference count by 2. Okay, we talked about how the reference count goes up. Now let's talk about how do you make sure that the reference count goes down. Or like, these objects, when you created the object at the first statement, x equals 10, the object is there in memory. But when does it get cleaned up? So we'll be decreasing the reference count. One way to decrement is change the reference. We had x equals 10, y equals 10, the object is there at 10, and then we have the x and y names pointing to it. Next statement, when I do x equals some string, y equals some boolean or any other change, what I do is the object is still there in memory, the reference count will go down. So x was earlier pointing to 10, now it's x is pointing to this string which has the value of abc. Another way is using the del keyword. I'm sure most everyone knows about the del keyword. So del, what it does, what does del actually do? It will remove that reference. But what do you think it will do? Does it delete the objects? Yep. It does not delete objects. It just removes that reference, the name as a reference to that object. So hence, at the end of the day, it just removes one, decrements the reference count. Third thing could be going out of scope. So we covered change the reference. Second was use the del keyword. Third is go out of scope. So when you you defined a variable x in the local namespace, as soon as that function finishes execution, the stack namespace gets removed from the stack. Similarly, the objects can be garbage collected. So we'll cover that in a while. So reference count was incremented for x for the object with value 10 when we assigned it x equals 10. Next thing, when the function finished and the control got back to the main program, it just removes that reference. What happens when there are no more references? Yep, it can be safely removed from the memory. Let's take a moment of zen, local versus global namespaces. I'm sure everyone of you would have read it or heard about it from someone using local over global namespaces, or like limiting the number of variables that you have in global namespace. Now you know why that is there. The objects that are created in global namespace, they never go out of scope. So one of the reasons we try to limit our global objects is this. And we definitely don't want to keep large or complex data in our global namespace, because it's never going to go out of scope. It is going to keep on consuming that memory till the program actually finishes. So this is really helpful when you are defining a service which is going to keep on running and there is no reboot, and it's just keeps on spinning. If you define, let's say, think of you define an object in memory in global namespace which consumes 150 MB of memory. That memory is going to be there till the program finishes, or like till you reboot that service. That's why choose your variables, whether does it really need to go in the global namespace or not. So let's start. This is how a object in Python looks like. Py object is the class in C. So there we have three, it has three columns, let's say three values associated to it, the type, the reference count, and the value. The type, it defines whether it's an integer, string, or what type of value it is. Then the ref count of that object, when I initially did x equals 10, y equals 10, the ref count was incremented to 2, and the value that it actually holds. Let's do a POC. Let's not just go by my words. If you define a quick function and then do those values, x equals equals y, it does the equality check. It compares the value of x at that location to the value at y location. But it, when you want to do comparison, whether they are actually pointing to the same object, you know, to use the is keyword. Is actually compares the references of those names. It does not compare the values. And if you want to ever want to get the memory address of that object that you, the name that you created, you can get it using the ID built-in function. And you can see on the right side, there are two names, X and Y, two references, but only one single object in memory. This is actually called interning. What Python does, this is like, it points immutable objects, in this case, integer or string, to same object in memory. So when you created the first object, X equals 10, it interns the 10. It knows that there is an object which has the value 10. I don't need to create any new object. I can assign that same object to this as a reference to this name now, when I did by equals 10. Python does this by default as a memory optimization technique. What if I, but it does, it may, you may think like you may want to do it manually by yourself in your program for some complex strings, because it does it only for immutable objects. How you can do it is like Python sys built-in module has a dot intern function. You can call that on the string or that whatever object you are creating, and it will intern that object. Next time you, when you do sys.intern again, it will point to the same reference. So it won't duplicate that object. So on the left side, if you see, we have a simple string, height by x equals that and y equals that. We do the ID and it returns the same address, and equality as well as the identity check matches. But what happens on the right side? We have the same string. If you see on the editor, it looks same. There is no changes at all, but the IDs are different and identity function fail, x is y fails. The reason being encoding. So for every string, it has different kinds of encoding. It's the exclamation mark. When it's done, created in memory, it has its own encoding. At the runtime, Python is not able to define that, whether it needs to go in the same object or not. So encoding is a little bit out of topic for this talk. I'm not gonna touch deeper into it, but I recommend you guys read about it. How you can do that for those objects, we talked about sysintern. On the right side, again, we have import the sys-module, sys.intern hotpy, assign it to x. When you do for y again, now the identity check also matches. So now we have the we created that object. Now let's consider that as the complex object that we talked about earlier. We have this object in memory. Now we created another. We didn't create end up creating a separate object for this. We just assigned that same reference to y variable, y name. And the pros of this is like when you have large complex objects, you can reduce the overall memory head. So memory, the overall memory of the entire program. But there are some consequences also associated to it. Whenever you call the intern method, it is going to have some CPU over it, because it is going to do some, it is going to take some CPU time to process that. But when and where you should use it? You should only use it in your program when you have a lot of repetitive strings, or like if, only then it is really helpful when you do interning by yourself. Otherwise, let Python handle it. And then if there are no repetitive strings, you may end up spending more CPU, as well as there would be more memory overhead. Let's talk about garbage collection. What is garbage collection? It is actually a way, so garbage collector in Python is a way so that whatever objects are no longer required, it cleans up those objects and frees up its memory. There are two types of garbage collection, mostly reference counting and tracing. Reference counting garbage collection. First thing is we talked about reference count. For any object, it stores a type, reference count, and the value. We can just keep on adding or removing the references to that object, and then whenever the ref count reaches for reaches zero for that object, we can safely remove it from memory. But does it actually remove only that object? Think about it. Let's say you have one parent object which is pointing to this child object. When this when the references to this parent object reach zero, this object will be removed. But this object also does not have any references. So now this object can also be garbage collected. So it will end up having a cascading effect. So this object had its reference count one, and the name was X. I del X, the reference got removed. Ref count reach zero over here. This parent child parent object got removed. This parent had a reference to this child object. Now child object only had one reference. As soon as this parent object got removed from memory, this child object's ref count also reaches zero. So this object can also be garbage collected. Similarly, it could have any other objects in the child node, and then cascading effect applies over there. The good about this, it's really easy to implement, because you just need to have an object in memory. You need to store it. Every time you do an operation on that object, you can increment or decrement its reference count. And as soon as the object reference count reaches zero, we can safely remove that object. Nothing comes with the only the good. There is always a space overhead, because whenever you have an object in memory, you are assigning some additional value to it, which is the reference count. So there is always going to be some space or memory overhead, and then execution overhead. As whenever you try to do any operation on that object, it is going to do something. Execution, it needs to increment or decrement the reference count on every assignment or like any operation at all. There are some challenges to it as well. We talked about, we have simple objects, del x, y, and those objects, we just assign the references to it. But what are cyclical references? I'll show by a small example. I just have a very simple class node, and then a value, and then a child object. Let's just take a minute for them to settle. Meanwhile, any questions so far? So I'll shortly, so the question is like, how do we get the reference count for an object? I'll shortly get to it. So we'll cover that. I'm sorry, what? Interning. Interning, yeah. Interning happens at the program level. So global level. So let's say whenever you when you run your first program, you run main.py, it is going to start interning from there. So Python interpreter does it, the compiler, garbage collector, the memory optimizer actually. So that keeps on doing it and default for any of the Python program that you execute. All right, so now coming back to this node, we have we created an object node with the value root. And then we assign that object with the reference, the name as root again. Similarly, left, right. By this, by the time we finish the execution on the fourth statement, we have three objects in memory, three names, and a reference count of all those three objects is just one. Next thing, when I do root dot child equals left, now I'm incrementing the reference count of left by one. So ref count becomes two for root left, the object with the value left. Left dot child right, the right reference count goes up by one. Right dot child left, left reference count goes up by one. How does it end up looking in memory? We have the object root. The reference count is just one, because at the statement two, when we assign that left, we just talked about it, it ends up having the reference count of three. Right, it ends up having the reference count of two. Now what actually happens when you do a call del or any other operation, or you went out of scope? But these objects are still there in memory, right? The reason why they are going to keep remaining in memory is when I did root equals del root. So root went away, the reference to root went away, root dot child reference can also go away, right? After that, left, when we did del left, it just removes one of the reference. So by now, left's reference count also goes down by two. It ends up only with one reference, because right's child is still pointing to the object left. Similarly for right, when we did del right, it removes that name. So that reference count goes down by one, but there is still a reference, because left is referring to right as its child. Now this is where tracing garbage collection comes into picture. So what does tracing use? It uses a mark and sweep algorithm. So it uses does it in two steps. First step is we talked about the Python stack and heap, right? That all the objects with the actual data are there in the heaps. So garbage collector, Python garbage collector knows where to start, where it needs to start looking for all the objects. It goes over there, it checks the objects, it tries to reach mark all those objects which are reachable. So whichever objects are not reachable, so let's say left and right are not actually reachable because there are references to it, but there is no name. So I can't actually refer to those objects via my own objects, right? When I refer to it in my program, there is no way for me to access those objects. Those objects are kind of dead to me. The garbage collector will go mark those objects which are reachable. So first stage is marking. Next stage is sweeping. So whichever objects are dead, so let's say consider the object on the left bottom. We have two objects, consider that as the left and right. They are both interlinked to each other, but there is no way to reach those objects. So they can be safely swept away. What does Python use? We talked about that garbage collection uses reference counting and tracing. Python uses reference counting plus generation of garbage collection, which is a type of tracing garbage collection. Now let's talk about. All right, so I'll just talk about generation of garbage collection. It is based on the theory that most objects die young. You remember the I in the for loop, for I and X and anything. So I is that very young object, which is definitely gonna die as soon as the for loop finishes. So those objects, so that's why it's based on the theory that most of the objects that you create, they're only there for a short period of time and they're gonna die as quickly as possible. Python actually maintains three lists of items of every object, which it calls as generations. So generation zero, the youngest objects, generation one, generation two, which are the most senior objects. And then newly objects, whenever we create any newly objects, they are assigned in the generation zero. So generation of garbage collection does not apply to your regular objects, which are like integer strings or any other, for any simple objects. It applies only for container objects because we definitely don't need generation of garbage collection for those simple objects, right? For simple objects, we can maintain the reference count. As soon as the reference count reaches zero, we can safely remove them. It's the cyclical references are coming as a problem for container objects. We saw it as part of classes. So that's why generation of garbage collection, it only applies for containers. And whenever the so what actually happens, when does the algorithm gets triggered, the generation of garbage collection? It only runs as soon as the threshold for that generation that we created, generation 0, 1, 2, as soon as the threshold hits, it runs that garbage collection algorithm. How you can get the garbage collection thresholds? GC is the built-in module. Using gc.getThreshold, you can get the threshold. So we get a tuple, generation 0, 1, 2. Generation 0 has 700 objects, which is the maximum that you need for a program, like for the threshold. And then generation 1, generation 2. So as soon as the number of objects in your generation 0 hit 700, it is going to run the garbage collection algorithm. So what is the cycle of generation of garbage collection looks like? Python makes a list of all the objects that it needs to discard. Mark and sweep again comes into picture. Then it runs the algorithm to detect the cyclical references. If object has no outside references, we talked about the cyclical references, that they are in memory, the left and right are pointing to each other, but they don't have any name in the outside, in the stack, that we can't actually reach those objects. So it just adds it to the discard list. When the cycle is done, we can safely remove those objects. So let's say at this 700 mark, we ran our garbage collection algorithm, and let's say 400 objects got removed. Now the 300 pending objects, they get promoted to generation one. And similarly, so this actually happens for any younger generations as well. So let's say for generation one, I hit my threshold again. It is gonna run the garbage collection for that generation plus the younger generation, generation zero. So it ran for generation one and then generation zero next. So we talked about garbage collection. We wanted to get the threshold. Similarly, there is a built-in method, gc.setThreshold, which using which you can set your own thresholds for your entire program. After the cycle finishes, the surviving objects are promoted to the next generation, and the objects that get promoted to the generation two, the final, the last generation, they stay over there for the entire program, because those are like they have already survived multiple garbage collection cycles, and that means those objects are that still being in use. So you cannot remove those objects. You can keep those objects. They'll stay there in memory till the end of the program's life cycle. Now the things about it, when the ref count reaches zero, it can the object gets removed immediately. We have the reference counting garbage collection. But in case of generational, we have to wait for that garbage collection algorithm to run for the objects to get freed up. Now, have you ever noticed like you have a program running for a long time and then you call Dell on your project on your program by yourself, or like you did some other changes, or like you had a very you got a huge response from an API. After using that response, you just your function went out of scope, and that API is not there. That object should is not there anymore. So the Python's program memory should reduce, right? But you may have seen that the memory does not actually reduce. What actually happens? Garbage collection ran, reference counting ran, but the memory is still there. So when you go to activity monitor or like task manager, you still see that the Python program does not shrink in memory. Fragmentation comes into picture. It's not what you are thinking about the OS fragmentation. What happens is like the program, yes, it won't shrink. That's for sure. Memory, what happens is like we created those objects. Those were not in a continuous block. Those were fragments of objects. So they get freed up because Python has a heap allocated to it. So in that heap, it just gets some fragmented blocks freed up. It does not get a continuous block freed up. And as soon, even though it gets that block freed up, it does not release that memory to the OS. It releases that memory to the Python heap again, so that when you create any new objects, Python can use that memory from that heap itself. It does not need to request additional resources from the OS. Some quick optimizations. So before I actually go into optimizations, I'd like to answer that question. So how do you get the references of an object? In the SS module, we have a get reference method using which you can pass the name, and you can get the number of referers for that object, for that name. Similarly, in the garbage collector module, we have get reference and get referers. I'll show you. So the result may have actually surprised you. You thought I just assigned x equals 10 as a single reference, right? It should only be one. Why does it show so many? Remember, when you load the program, it loads all the things. It loads all the modules from sys.paths, right? So those paths, x is a very commonly used variable. Now you get to know that. So it actually checks the name x in all the modules in this paths that is it has already loaded. So that's why the reference count will always be higher for this. So there is actually another way, get reference, that you can also use gc.get reference. With that, you can pass the object and get, I'll show you the help. Returns the list of the objects that are directly referred to, to by the objects. Right, so using these we can see that. Now let's jump back to the quick optimizations in lieu of time again, and the quick optimizations that you can do as part of your programs to make sure that it does not consume a lot of memory. Before we actually jump into that, let's rewind back on dictionaries versus tuples. So when you create dictionaries, it has three values actually: the hash, the reference pointing to the key, reference pointing to the value. So that's the way dictionary stores its data. And then we have tuples, which are like completely immutable. Whatever objects you assign to it, you cannot modify its value, neither can you increase or decrease the tuple size. When we create an empty dictionary or an empty tuple, we can see that this dictionary ends up taking 248 bytes of data size, and then tuple takes only 56 bytes. An empty dictionary we are talking about right now, because dictionary, when we create a dictionary, it assigns some memory for some objects. So when you keep on adding some objects, it won't go till it reaches the threshold. At that threshold, dictionary is gonna duplicate in double in size. So 248, it is just gonna jump to 526. You can do the maths. Let's talk about slots. So when you create any classes, right? By default, it uses dictionaries for storing those objects, the variables that you assign in it, or like any variables that you assign to that class. It uses dictionaries to store that data. Let me just take this as an example quickly. I'm creating a simple class X, creating two variables in the init, A, B, and assigning two values to it. So very simple class. I don't do anything else. I create the object. We can see that right now its size is only 64 bytes. But when I actually want to see how the objects are represented in the memory, like how they are actually created, we can refer to the dict. So this is how objects in the for a class, the variables in the class are stored in memory. It creates a dictionary, and then whatever variables names we have as part of that class, it will assign that as the keys and then the values. Now this ends up taking a lot of space as you keep on increasing the memory. What you can do with slots is, like, let's say in production you happen to have a class where you know how that class will end up having a lot of thousands or millions of instances. We just see one object right now. As soon as we keep on creating more and more objects, it is going to end up creating taking more and more memory. And we already saw the difference between dictionary and tuple size. So every time it is going to keep on increasing. What you can do with slots is, like, we'll cover that in a minute. So let's first see the slots in implementation. You remember, right? When we created the class X, in the init we just defined A and B. What if I do X equals C, X dot C equals A, B, C? No, I want to do first for X. You remember that I created the class X and assigned a variable X to it. So that is the instance where I just defined A and B in the init, right? But now when I create another third object C, it'll just create that object, x dot underscore dict. It just adds that object in the dictionary, and then the size will also keep on increasing, right? But what if I want to live, I know already that my how many instance variables I'll have as part of that dictionary, as part of that class, right? I can use slots. With slots, I assign, I don't get the dict. Dict is not there anymore. I can only get the slots. I see that I assigned the tuple A and B. What if I try to do y dot c equals? You remember in any string, most of you will remember the attribute error, that this object does not have this attribute. Similar thing is what we are going to see over here. So y does not have an attribute c, because in slots, it is a tuple. Now we have locked it down that these are the only member variables that it can have, this class instance can have. So it won't go beyond that. So now we have limited how much memory can this class actually take. It won't go beyond that. The dictionaries, you can keep on adding more instances, and then the size is going to keep on increasing. With tuples, we reduce that size. So when do you use slots? When you are creating many instances of class, and you know in advance what properties that class should have. Slots actually also gives you faster attribute access. So with saving the memory as well, you're getting faster CPU, you're getting faster attribute access as well, saving some CPU time. For the reading, I recommend you go through this article. Another thing is weak reference. We talked about references. Whenever you create an object or like x equals 10, then you do y equals x. The reference count goes up to 2 now, right? What if I want to create it as a weak reference? Where is it first applicable? When you are creating any large objects, but you just want its mapping, whether that object is still there or not, so that I can use it, maybe in mappings or caches. What it does is it does not increment the reference count. It associates it as a weak reference, so that as soon as the main object that was actually the name it was referring to, that object, it goes out of scope or it gets removed, the reference count reaches zero, and only the reference left are weak references. The object can be garbage collected. So it is only for mapping, but it is saying to say that I want this object, but I don't want you to keep this object in memory alive only because of me. I wanted to do a quick demo on weak reference as well, but shortage of time, maybe I'll just take a minute. Just created an empty class X, nothing, basic object, created an instance, created a weak reference to that instance and assigned it to Y. If you see X, it is an object. Y, it is actually a weak reference to that same object. We see that it's the same object in memory. It does not create any new object now. If I want to create any object from this weak reference, I can just do like, it'll give me that object. But that's why it is recommended to check whether this object is alive or not. Now, how do we make sure that this object is alive what happens now? When I do del of x, remember this small x was the instance to that class, the x. If you check y now, it says it's dead. So it does not wait for that object. It does not keep that object alive in memory. As soon as I delete the parent object, which were now I was only having a weak reference. Remaining references were weak. We garbage collected that object. The weak reference is dead. When I tried to create object now, it is going to return me none. It just returns none now. What all did we cover? If it's not visible, so Python has names, references, objects. So now we know that there are no variables actually in Python. It just has the objects are there in memory, and we just store their references using names. We talked about garbage collection, two ways of garbage collection: reference counting and tracing. What Python uses, generational garbage collection. Garbage collection is pretty good because it helps you keep ensure that it does not your program does not keep on increasing its size. And then we also talked about why the Python program does not shrink in memory after GC. Slots we covered, how you can optimize, and then there is actually an article that is also there, plus some additional readings on VCrypt. So these are a couple of the sources that are some of the sources that I refer to for preparing this talk. I do recommend going over these additional readings: Python module of the week, garbage collection. Then this is the actual article I was talking about under Dunder slots, how it helps you. It saved the 9 GB of RAM in production. Their case was like they were consuming 25 GB of RAM in production. By just changing to slots, they came down 9 GB and came to 16 GB now. So it's a pretty good read. I recommend going through it. Python optimization, the weak reference documentation. Try to understand like how you can optimize it in your while maintaining your caches or mapping. And this blog on Adam Gulbin's blog on Python memory management. Any questions? Okay, yes, we covered the GC module, right? GC has a method gc.collect. When you call collect, it will trigger the garbage collection. You can do it manually on your So memory is in blocks, right, in OS. So what happens is like this memory, when you created Python, you assign Python heap to the Python program. So Python program has this continuous block, but it has which actually has continuous blocks of memory, right? Now when you created object and that object got removed, it is still there in this continuous block, is still assigned to OS has given up this continuous block to Python, right? So this block inside that we got fragments free now. So the Python interpreter will the garbage collection, as soon as that block is free, it is given back to the Python's heap. So Python, when you let's say you created x equals 10 in your local namespace, and when you went out of local namespace, that object got freed, that memory is available now, but your main program is still running. When you do abc equals xyz, that object needs some memory. It sees that there is this memory available. I don't need to request some additional resources from the OS. I can use this block. Does that clarify? Again, yes, that is there, but you can just remove it. So what I meant to say was like, as soon as it goes out of scope, my point was, it was not a good reference, sorry. So yes, it was the reference was more like, as soon as you go out of scope, that variable is that object does not no longer exist, right? So we can, it gets garbage collected. I'm sorry, he's been waiting for a while. Execution time, you will see that global namespace accessing the variables will be a little faster because they are in the global heap, right? The global stack. But then it will the memory will still live till the end of the program, till the program dies. So we are talking about it, let's say in production, right? You have a service running. It is not going to be like a program that you just run for a period and then it stops execution and then it restarts after some time. It is going to be a continuous service. So when you, in that case, when you are creating some objects in global namespace, it is going to live till the service you actually kill it, or like you restart it. Till that time, that object is going to be there in memory. You will have some slightly better CPU time because accessing that those objects will be faster. But those objects will keep on living, so that memory will always keep on increasing for those objects as and when you create more objects in the global namespace. The variables that you have defined, so the actual, let's say you defined some, you made some API call and you store its result in main, after main in a global variable, and you are referring that global variable in some other objects as well, some other modules as well. That global variable is still there in memory, so the memory size is over there. It is going to stay over there in the memory. So accessing that attribute is going to be faster because it is there, right? In the global namespace, it is accessing the attribute will be slightly faster, yes, but the object will never go out of memory. So the memory consumption will still remain the same. You cannot optimize it. Now the question comes is like, do you really need that object to remain in the global namespace till the program, till your program finishes? If you need, then there is no other way around it. But if you, the question that I want you to ask next time you're doing something like that, do I really need this object in the global namespace? Can I move it to some other local namespace and then get rid of it as soon as possible? Yes. Yes, again, the question is like, do we see any impact of garbage memory management on like when a program has been running for a longer period of time? As we talked about, you keep on creating some objects, it is going to request those resources from OS, and Python's heap size is going to keep on increasing. When those objects get free, the memory does not get relocated back to the OS. It remains in the Python's heap. So we may not see a lot of optimizations, but the biggest pro that I see of this is like, you created those objects got removed. Now you have some additional space for creating new objects as well, for making some new API calls, or like fetching the state of your server, again, keep on polling it, and then without consuming additional resources. So with this, if you keep it in that way. Sorry, we don't have more time for questions. I'll be at the back. We have to start with the next talk. I'll be at the back. I'm here till the evening. You can. Hello.
Jagdish is asking that empty dict has around more than 100 bits of memory, but when we create a class object internally, it contains a dict, right? And then it has a size of 64 bits. Why is that?
Whenever we just saw that, right? When you create any dictionary, it assigns some memory to it because it assigns it as like five objects. Let's say I'm just taking a raw number. So five objects is what you can assign in the dictionary. You don't want to keep on increasing the dictionary. So think about it. When you are creating any dictionary and you assign some memory to it, you assign zero memory to it, it just is an empty dictionary. Next time you add an object, it needs to go check. I don't have any memory for adding this object. I need to get some additional memory from the OS. That is going to have some overhead. You did the first assignment in the dictionary. You added another object in the dictionary. It is again going to request some additional resources from the OS. That is more overhead. So what Python does by default is like it takes some memory from the OS. This is the default memory I'm going to give you to at the beginning of the program. Now, when you have the this dictionary can now have, let's say, five elements. As soon as we reach a fifth element, and now when we try to add a sixth element, it is going to see that my memory is, I have reached my limit. It is going to go to the OS, request double its size. So what Python does is like similarly for lists as well. You created a list, it has two elements. And now it had only the size for storing two elements. As soon as you try to add third, it is going to double in size. It is not just going to create a new list in the memory with just one additional element. It is going to create a list in the memory so that it can hold four elements now. Next time you reach four, try to add the fifth element, it is going to double again. Now you can store up to eight elements. So that's what Python does, so that it reduces the overhead and it does not need to go to the OS again and again and request those sources, resources. I mean, in that case, why not use tuples? Tuples are more efficient than lists, right? If you know that your list is only going to have 10 elements, as soon as it reaches that buffer, you can just convert it into a tuple and let discard that list. With that, you save some memory, and then that list tuple is immutable. That also ensures that you don't like unnecessarily override or like to make any changes to that data, because that data is like you want to keep that data as it is. What's next? I'm just thinking of planning a talk on optimizations in Python. What I'm planning to cover as part of that next talk, this is not planned for any time sooner. So best practices in Python,